Hold on. There you are. I do have a congregation this morning. All right. I think that those are all the announcements. So you're going to all stand up. We're going to do a call to worship this morning because you know where we were last year at this time? Y'all know? We were driving through the parking lot last year, taking communion, and the staff was out there making posters and displays and all that kind of stuff. And this morning we were in the parking lot, but we were there by choice, and we were outside, and we were not in cars. Unless you wanted to be. I'm not sure you would have heard much, but you could have been, I suppose. But we're out in the parking lot by choice. So we are here in the building this year, a year later. We still got masks, still 6 feet apart, and everything gets sanitized after every worship service, but we are here. So, with that in mind, may the light of Christ, who rises this day in glory, scatter the darkness of our hearts and minds. Let us pray. Almighty God, pour out your abundant blessing on this lighted candle so that all who share in your holy mysteries may be filled with your grace and spiritual blessing. Once we were in darkness, but since we have become the Lord's people, we are in the light. Help us to live as people who belong to the light, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hold on. Don't start without me. Let me light the candle. There we go. You aren't offended that I used this, are you?
No. Okay.
You're pretty easy. Are you ready?
Ready.
Here we go. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right. And that's good, but we're going to reverse this because that's the way the call to worship is. So you get three chances. And I'll say it with you, okay? You ready?
Ready.
Here you go. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Are we supposed to do it like that?
All right. Oh, sit down.
No.
All right. Actually, I'm going to have him stand back.
You're going to have him stand right back
I'm
up.
Telling you. All right. And if you can't laugh.
That's right.
Are you all set?
Yes.
You ready to worship? We are so glad that you were here this morning.
Yes.
And we are so glad the folks who are online are with us as well. I'm all excited because Bob and June Hazelton are coming back this morning. So we've had folks the last 3 weeks returning to us as they have gotten their shots this year. And that's been kind of fun. So I'm looking forward to Bob and June being here. And I'm glad to see all of you. So.
All right. I am going to ask you to stand back up. Happy Easter, everybody. We are so excited. We've got some fun, moving songs. We will not be playing slow at the beginning here because we are excited. So please join us in singing Glorious Day. I was buried beneath my shame. Could carry that kind of weight. It was my doom till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried. Was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Day.
shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I breathe in. I have a future. My eyes are open. Because you call my name. And I ran out of that grave. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
So happy that we are celebrating Easter and that Jesus rose up from the grave. Please join us in a more traditional song, Christ Arose. Final song for right now is Christ the Lord is risen today.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Sons of men and angels say, and triumphs high. death is now thy sting. Alleluia. Once he died, our souls to save.
So, prayer requests. Anybody have any good news? How about the Leprods? Hey, it's good to have you back this morning. Yeah? Good to see you. It's been a while. So, I guess this means you have your shots. That's right. All righty. So, oh, more good news?
The football team won last night and will hopefully be on to the playoffs.
All right. Off to the playoffs. All right. Speaking of which, if y'all could pray for NBC Sports that they would give us baseball back, I would appreciate that. I know you're all on football in the spring, which is kind of weird, but also, anything else this morning? Are we good? I wanted to share with you, if you did not catch, that Curtis Jones's daughter is at UVA. She's had a tube put in to bypass her stomach. She's after some medicine they were waiting for that they did not have in the United States. So they were waiting, but if you go to Facebook, then you can read his post, and that should clarify everything. Frances Williams called and wanted to wish you all a very happy Easter, and she specifically wanted to thank the youth, again, who put their stuff in the devotional book. That's been quite the hit this year, so she just wanted to make sure that somebody heard that she really enjoyed the youth. And if you put an entry in... she didn't mention you. I'm sorry. She's just all excited about the kids. So, and she said she's doing well and is healthy. So, Brittany's grandmother still in hospice care, I assume.
Yes.
All right. And saw Bootsy. She came out Thursday night for communion. By the time you get done counting everybody, it may have been 65 folks who came through. That was the bigger of the two services, which was, it was nice. It was nice to serve communion and get to visit with everybody as they came through. That was a treat. I don't get to see some of you. And the first person to come through the line was Eddie Cruz. So I haven't seen, and Eddie looks so much better. He's growing a beard. You can all stop and contemplate what Eddie looks like in a beard. It didn't sound like he'd ever grown one before, but, or at least it's been a very, very long time. So, but Eddie came through and took communion. He had a chance to get caught up with him. Sandy Hill was here Friday for the Good Friday service. Shocked us all because she was sure she wouldn't be here. Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm done. I just wanted to share that Sandy was here. Okay. All right. And I think that is everybody on my list. Are we good? Is there anything I have missed? Now is the time. This is the hour. Yes, sir. All right, thank you. Thank you. If you guys didn't let me know, I wouldn't know. So there you go. Appreciate that. If you go in the hospital, just a call. I mean, I know you got better things to do, and I won't hold you responsible if you don't call, but just to let us know. I can't at this point, I don't think. I'm still not allowed to go visit. Have they changed that? Anybody know? Anyway, so. All right. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. We give you thanks, most gracious God. We give you thanks for the resurrection message. And that it wasn't just about the resurrection, but it was about the Jesus who walked among us, that we would make sure we understood. we understood what the resurrection was all about, what it meant when you said you would never leave us nor forsake us, what it meant when you broke bread with us after the resurrection, not just before. We give you thanks, O God, that today we celebrate the kingdom coming and the coronation of a king. Those days are not far off, and you will spend them with us, making sure that we are ready and that we understand. May we have ears to hear in the next few weeks as we get ready to celebrate the ascension. We ask, most gracious God, especially that you would be with those whom we have named. We cannot be with them, but we know your Spirit can. And your Spirit knows their needs before we even ask this morning. We give you thanks that your Spirit goes out from this place, that our prayers go up as incense to you, and the Spirit goes out in strength and power and healing to answer our prayers. We pray this morning for each other, for our church, for our state, for our country and our world. And we pray this Easter morning that the Spirit may brood upon the waters of this world as it did once long ago, and create in us a clean heart that we might have a clean world. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, Alice Armentrout is going to share special music with us, and we're very excited for that.
I'd like to thank David for being here too this morning to play for me.
The marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets, all the harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the king comes through the gate. Happy faces line the hallways. Those whose lives have trumpet sounding, and now his
Well, I'm not sure what I'm going to say after that. I think I'm just going to say, now you have something to be thankful for. So we'll let the band play and allow you to offer your thanksgiving to God.
Thank you.
It's scaring me. There we go. All right. Technology is a wonderful thing when it works. All right. Our texture this morning is Luke, the 24th chapter, verses 8 through 12. Then they remembered Jesus' words. They left the tomb and broke the news of all this to the 11 and the rest. And to the sunrise, folks, here it comes. Here it comes. Are you ready? Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them kept telling these things to the apostles. That's like a present active participle. You can all go home and Google that if you don't remember from high school English, which meant the women just kept on talking and talking, and the men, what did the men do, guys? In one ear, out the other. But the apostles didn't believe a word of it. They thought they were making it all up. But Peter jumped to his feet and ran to the tomb. He stopped to look in and saw a few grave clothes. That's all. He walked away puzzled, shaking his head. Peter raced to the tomb. You've heard it before. This is not your first Easter celebration, right? You know from the Gospel of John that Peter was not the first to arrive at the tomb. It was the beloved disciple, the one who made sure he put it in his own book, okay, the one who got closest to Jesus at the Last Supper. Take that, you community of Peter believers. I am the beloved disciple, and I have written my own gospel, making sure that I show up at all the appropriate moments. Hey, I'm sure he does it in all humility. I'm sure he does. But it's just kind of fun to jerk his chain just a little bit. But I just want you to know this morning that Luke is silent on this point that the beloved disciple feels you need to understand and tries to make clear for you in another gospel, in another version of the movie. Because Luke has a point to make this morning. And there is no doubt in our minds that the beloved disciple got there first. But Luke has that point to make. So what I want us to do this morning is to kind of pull the Gospels apart, if you will. And if you would just do me the honor of just listening to Luke this morning. Just listen to Luke and what Luke has to say. There are some things that happened in Luke chapter. Chooses not to talk about them. It doesn't mean they didn't happen. It just means he's trying to make a particular point. And if we start amalgamating stuff and squishing it all together, we kind of lose Luke's point. So just, can you give him four verses? Can you do that for me today? Can you just leave John out of it for just a brief moment and just take a look at Luke? I know you can, because we've listened to Luke for what, 40 days and 6 Sundays, right? 40 days and 6 Sundays. We have listened to him in Bible study, Monday nights, Wednesday, Thursday nights. We have listened to him in worship, and we have listened in our private devotional times to what Luke has had to say. And sometimes we even found ourselves listening in the parking lot, not to mention Thursday night and snowflakes in particular, but Peter listened. All the disciples listened in the Gospel of Luke. What they heard was the witness of the women from the tomb. And the women told the disciples an incredible story that morning. It was a witness to the vindication of Jesus. It was a witness to exaltation. So let me explain. There was, my friends, an intent to kill Jesus, an intent to kill him exactly as they did. There was a reason for everything that week, at least on the part of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and on the part of Rome. What they did, what those religious leaders did, was as close to the curse of hanging a man on a tree outside the city as they could muster, given the restrictions that Rome had placed on them. Jesus died, my friends, on Friday, cursed by Jewish law, or so they thought. And not only was he cursed by Jewish law, but they attempted to shame him and kill him and do as much damage to him as they could according to the Jewish law. You have to remember, this is all being done by a high priest who has a torture chamber, literally a torture chamber. Been there, done that, seen it, in his basement. I'm not sure at what point your religious establishment has to be at that your senior pastor has to have a torture chamber in his basement. Now, they may have thought about it from time to time, but as yet, I have found no one who has actually done that. Not only was he shamed and killed by the Jewish law, but he was convicted, taunted, and tortured by the Gentiles as well. There was intent not only to kill Jesus, but to embarrass him, to shame him, and to send his soul to hell, making sure no shred of honor was left on the face of this earth for any of his followers to follow. Understand the intent of the cross. The Jews and the Gentiles intended to have an end to this. It was over. It was time for it to be over. And they did everything they could to make sure that it was. But what if they could not kill him? Several theories in recent, and when I say recent, I have to go back to, I'm not even going to remember the name of it, the one where they figured Jesus didn't really die and he went off and married Magdalene and all that kind of that ridiculous stuff. Those things have been floating around for centuries. But what if you couldn't kill him to begin with? What if he were innocent of the crimes to which he was accused? What if he was innocent of the crimes for which he was slain? What if Jesus had not been guilty? What if Jesus chose his fate, hence the word passion? What if Jesus chose his fate that he might free the very persons who were committing the acts of violence against him? How would you know? How would you know? How would you know if that was true? How would you know that the people putting him to death were lying? Well, for starters, if he were raised from the dead. If he were raised from the dead, that would kind of put a crimp in the whole Jewish-Roman plot thing. You can't have people rising from the dead and walking around. That doesn't do well for your story. If Jesus were raised from the dead, then it would mean that his words were true. And his sacrifice would be vindicated. And indeed, he would be exalted. Now, we're not going to get to the exaltation part, but trust me, by the time you get to the end of Luke's gospel, the very last thing to happen at the end of Luke's gospel is what? Here's your quiz today. Anybody get really excited these 40 days and read ahead to the end of the book? I didn't think so. I didn't either. I did when I put the sermon together, so that's what happened. There are three more stories in the Gospel of Luke. 7:30 people, or 7 o'clock people. What's the next story? Do you remember? Walk to Emmaus. There we go. Carolyn, they remembered. this was her object lesson because they broke bread and had breakfast together. Actually, it was supper, but at Emmaus. The next point he meets them is in the upper room, right? And then we have the ascension. So Luke ends with the ascension, but we're not there today. The resurrection, my friends. Jesus rising from the dead is what the women bear witness to. And that is what the angels remind the women of. And they bring to them, those two angels, to the women, the words of Jesus fulfilled. And those two women bear witness of the resurrection of Jesus to the 11. And you'll recall from today's text, right, that the 11 all listened intently to what the women were telling them, and their hearts were strangely warmed, just like John Wesley, and they all believed the women, right? Is that how the story goes? Is that how it happens? No. Now, in all fairness, if I'd been closed in a room, afraid for my life, oh my gosh, this sounds like the pandemic, doesn't it? If you've been closed in a room, afraid for your life, not eating much and not sleeping well, and wearing a mask and stayed 6 feet, you know, it sounds like the disciples were in the middle of a pandemic, but they weren't. They were crowded in an upper room. So you begin to understand that you get a little cranky, right? You get a little cranky. I might have heard the women with a little bit of skepticism. Be careful this morning, because in this story, the saints are not who you think they are. You and I, we would have laid odds on the 11. I would have laid odds on the 11. I have read the story. I know who goes to the tomb first, right? I've been doing this forever, but if you were to ask me 6 months from now, and yeah, you may get the answer. If you ask me 6 months from now in the middle of June, when I'm not getting ready for Easter, who is it that Jesus appears to after he was raised from the dead? My answer is probably going to be what? The 11. Because Jesus is going to appear to the 11. And he'll get around to it just before he leaves. Who's the first? Who are the first to discover the resurrection? It's not the 11. Luke says you got it wrong. You got it wrong when you bet your money on the 12, right? You got it wrong. Because now there's only 11. You really got it wrong if you put your money on Judas, right? But what Luke wants you to understand, and you may remember, is that all the disciples were guilty of the same thing. It didn't just have to be Judas. So if you're laying money on the 12, you're going to be sadly mistaken. God chose. Ooh. God chose. God chose whomever the ministry on lay committee, lay service committee chose, right? God chose who the pastor chose. God chose who the committee members chose, right? No. God chose the women. God chose the women. And this morning, I want you to listen to them. Because they are bearing witness to what they have seen and what they have heard and what Jesus told them. I want you to listen to them this morning. Perhaps it is because no one had risen from the grave before. Excuse number one. Perhaps it was because those women were so new to the group. They didn't show up till very late in Jesus' Galilean ministry. Excuse number two. Perhaps those women didn't have enough education or hadn't been to lay speakers school in their district, or they hadn't been to seminary. Perhaps it was because, I don't know, who listens to women anyway? See, some of you are not old enough to remember when a woman's place was in the home. And some of us are. Now, I'm just here to tell you that my father was the head of the household as long as my mother let him be. Okay, but there was always an official standing. And I'm sure the disciples just sat there and think, oh, that's that talk they do when they go to the well. That's that they're making stuff up. That's the kind of talk they have when they're baking the bread and threshing out the wheat. No need to be listening. But I'm here to tell you, God will choose whom God will choose. And God chose the women. Be careful who you think the saints are in this story, because you may not get it right. So Peter runs to the tomb. Let me ask you, why do you think he ran to the tomb? This is one of those unfair questions I always ask my Bible study people. What do you think? You're wrong. Before you even answer, you're wrong. I do that because I had professors in seminary who did that. So what do you think? You're wrong. That's why you're in my class, because you're wrong. Is it because he believes? Where in the text does it say Peter believed? Where does it say in the text that Peter had faith? It says Peter was amazed. Maybe he wanted to believe. Maybe Peter was hoping that he would find what the women saw. We want him to believe. And he's got to believe, and he will believe eventually, but not today. Not today. And do you know why he won't believe today? There's nobody left at the tomb. When he gets there, who's there? Nobody. Nobody. Peter finds an empty tomb, and there's nobody there to explain to him what that means. There's nobody there to explain to him what that means. Let me share something with you this morning. It comes from my history minor in college, I guess. Events need explaining. You understand what I'm saying? You find an empty tomb, it could mean anything. It could mean anything. And so Peter stands in amazement because the stone's been rolled back, and the grave clothes are there, but the two angels are gone. And all Peter can do is stand in amazement. Now, let me suggest to you that if Peter had paid attention and believed what the women had told him, what the women had borne witness to, Luke wouldn't say Peter was amazed. One can be amazed at the multiplication of loaves and fishes, yet not be willing to hear the word of suffering that comes with that feeding. One may be amazed at one who teaches with authority and yet never believe a word he says. Amazement is not belief. Like I said, Peter will believe, but just not today. Not today. Today, Luke says, today belongs to who? Today belongs to the women. Today belongs to the women. Because God chose them. And the women become what? They become witnesses. They become witnesses to Jerusalem and to Judea and to the ends of the earth. Heard that anywhere before? Anybody know where that's from? Wife of mine, where is that from? It's the beginning of Acts. It's almost like Luke is getting you ready for his second book, for his sequel. It's almost like Luke is getting you ready. It's almost like the story of the resurrection has to travel from Jerusalem to Judea to the ends of the earth, and that message has to go out for every single human being to hear, and he chooses the women on Easter Sunday morning to begin that process of bearing witness to the resurrection that very first morning. And if Peter had heard the witness and believed the witness and listened to the witness, then Peter would have had faith and understood what he found at the empty tomb. God will choose whoever God will choose to bear witness. And they inevitably will not be we expect. There's work to be done. There is a world to be saved. And God will choose to bear witness whoever God will choose. Who's the major figure in the book of Acts? Who is it? Who's most of the book of Acts about? Paul. He's about Paul, right? If you were going to pick an apostle, if you were going to pick someone to follow Jesus, would you pick Paul? Would you pick the guy who's persecuting the young Christians and throwing them into jail and hauling them back to Jerusalem? Is that the guy you would pick? It's almost like Luke is saying, let's start with the women, and then maybe you won't be so surprised when God chooses Paul. God's in the habit of choosing people that you wouldn't expect. Today belongs to the women, my friends. It belongs to the women at the tomb. And before you brush them aside, and before you don't listen to them, you need to hear their witness. Because there's a world to be saved. And we need to listen. The women will be the first to believe and carry the news of the resurrection out into the world. Today, my friends, today belongs to the women at the tomb. Listen to them. Listen to them. I have no microphone for communion, so I was stupid and I didn't go up to Pete. So, Jeff Smith, you're my usher, right? Well, one of you guys who are ushers, you or Michelle, would you grab the microphone and bring it up? Because otherwise we're about to have 20 minutes. Oh, I see. You're gonna make me watch lift cups and break bread and hold the microphone all at the same time. Am I on? All right. We're good. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed. Oh, no. I'm fine. I'm gonna do this unmasked, and I just y'all keep your distance, 6 feet. It's okay. I'm just busting your chops, that's all. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he blessed it and he gave it to his disciples. Did that in the 9th chapter? Well, he didn't break the bread in the 9th chapter, but he talked about what it means in the 9th chapter and the 18th chapter. And he broke it And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." Remember what he said to the women? Remember what he said to the disciples? The Son of Man is to be handed over, what? Be killed. His body is to be broken, in other words. And likewise, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and he took the cup, and he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you. Take and drink all of this as often as you remember me." I have one member of this congregation before the pandemic, and I would serve communion. And every time I serve communion, the one member of the congregation will come up, and they will take the communion elements from me, and they will say, "I remember. I remember." That's Luke. That's Luke. "I remember. I remember what you said. I remember that somehow the resurrection makes the suffering and the sacrifice all right. Somehow it justifies it in the end. Somehow it creates hope for us to go on." And so we pray that these might be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might remember. We might listen to the women and hear the angels at the tomb and remember the words of Jesus, "The body and blood of Christ shed for you."
And he said, "Come to the table, come join the sinners. To the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed and who forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the
Would you stand? God has chosen you this morning. My goodness, he's chosen you. Sometimes we wait, right? You wait for Peter. You wait for the pastor. You wait for the Sunday school teacher. You wait for the administrative council chair. You wait for the bishop. You wait for somebody who's been coming to Sunday school 24 years. You wait for somebody. You just showed up to get the body ready. That's all you did. And God chose you this morning. God chose you. O women at the tomb, God chose you to bear witness of the resurrection to the world. He chose you. Go and tell somebody. Amen.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old of heaven.